Hi everyone. Today in this video, let us discuss one of the new drug, Semaglutide. What is this drug Semaglutide? The suffix glutide indicates that this drug is acting on diabetes, and Semaglutide is classified as GLP-1 receptor agonist. GLP is nothing but glucagon-like peptide. So this GLP-1 can control the blood glucose levels by increasing the insulin secretion from the pancreas, and it also increases the glucagon action, which opposes in the elevation of blood glucose levels. In this way, GLP-1 can control the blood glucose levels, but it is having few of the limitations. Glucagon-like peptide is having the short duration of action, and it can be converted into metabolites by one of the enzyme DPP4, dipeptidyl peptidase 4. So this enzyme can control the action of GLP-1, so GLP-1 shows very short duration of action. So this is the endogenous mediator which can control the glucose levels, but it has a limitation of short duration of action. Now semaglutide is a GLP-1 receptor agonist which acts just like GLP-1. So it also increases the insulin secretion as well as glucagon action. But at the same time, this drug is not metabolized by DPP4 enzyme. That's why this drug is somewhat long acting and it can control the excessive glucose levels in the diabetic patients. So semaglutide is having two advantages. It is not metabolized by DPP4 enzyme, which increases the bioavailability of this drug. And second important thing is that semaglutide can bind to albumin. When this drug binds to albumin, it cannot be easily metabolized, even it cannot be easily cleared by renal clearance. So this drug can stay within the blood circulation for longer periods. That's why this drug is one of the long-acting GLP-1 agonist. Hence, semaglutide can be used in the management of type 2 diabetes mellitus along with diet and exercise. And for this purpose, this drug is available as tablet as well as subcutaneous injection. Semaglutide not only reduces the glucose levels, but it also reduces the appetite. Thereby, it can reduce the body weight. That's why this drug can be used in the management of obesity. In those patients with body mass index greater than 30 kg per square meter, this semaglutide can be given as subcutaneous injection. But one of the important thing is that the subcutaneous injection which is intended for obesity is not equivalent to the subcutaneous injection indicated for diabetes mellitus. Since the dosage and strengths are somewhat variable, even route of administration is similar, but they are indicated for different purpose. So this drug is useful in the management of type 2 diabetes mellitus as well as for management of obesity. And particularly among the GLP-1 agonists, semaglutide is available as oral formulation to control the diabetes mellitus. Similarly, this drug shows beneficial effect in the management of obesity, as it reduces the appetite, resulting in the decreased body weight in the patients. But this drug is not indicated in the children. It is only available for the treatment of obesity in the adults. Apart from these, this drug is having few of the limitations. But semaglutide should not be given in the patients with pancreatitis. Since this drug produces pancreatitis, it is not indicated in the patients with any history of pancreatitis. Similarly, this drug is not useful in the treatment of type 1 diabetes, which is associated with insulin deficiency. And even semaglutide is not the first-line therapy for the management of diabetes mellitus. It can be combined with other drugs to produce efficient control on blood glucose. And this drug is available as a oral tablet form, which improves the patient compliance. So today in this video, we are going to see how this drug acts, what are the important precautions, dosage forms, and what are the doses for different clinical indications. All these things we will discuss in this video. Now let us the chemical nature of this drug. Semaglutide is one of the peptide with a different sequence of amino acids, just like the GLP-1, but the structure is somewhat modified at two positions. One of the position is the 26th position, where this amino acid is going to be replaced with a spacer device combined with C18 fatty diacid. So this improves the binding of semaglutide to the serum albumin, which reduces the clearance and metabolism, leading to long duration of action. Similarly, the amino acid at the 8th position is going to be modified, such that this drug is not metabolized by DPP-4 enzyme. So these two modifications result in the increased stability and increased duration of action. Now let us see how this drug acts. Semaglutide can produce its action by acting on three organs. Its main action is attributed to its action on pancreas, where from the beta cells it can increase the insulin secretion, resulting in the decreased glucose levels. Similarly, this drug can act on the brain, where it can reduce the appetite. So because of loss of appetite, semaglutide can reduce the body weight. That's why it can be used in the management of obesity. Similarly, this drug can also produce some delayed gastric emptying, resulting in the decreased absorption of glucose. By all these actions, semaglutide can be used in the treatment of type 2 diabetes mellitus as well as in the treatment of obesity. So on the beta cells, GLP-1 receptors are expressed, which are G-protein coupled receptors coupled with alpha beta gamma subunits. Now semaglutide can act on this GLP-1 receptor, which results in the activation leading to stimulation of adrenal cyclase system. By activation of this enzyme, now ATP can be converted into cyclic AMP. This cyclic AMP plays as an important role within the beta cells. It can stimulate one group of enzymes, protein kinase A. This protein kinase A can control the activity of various ion channels. It can impact the activity of ATP sensitive potassium channels, through which potassium can go outside, and voltage-gated calcium channels and voltage-gated sodium channels. Now, protein kinase A can inhibit this ATP sensitive potassium channels so that potassium cannot go outside. At the same time, it can stimulate the calcium channels so calcium can enter into the beta cells, resulting in the depolarization. Similarly, it can stimulate the sodium channels, resulting in the entry of sodium. By all of these actions, beta cells are depolarized, resulting in the release of insulin from the beta cells. In this way, semaglutide can increase the insulin secretion from the beta cells, thereby it can reduce the blood glucose levels. Similarly, this drug can also increase the glucagon secretion, which reduces the glucose levels. And this drug can also act on the brain, thereby it can reduce the appetite, leading to a significant reduction in the body weight. Now let us see the precautions of this drug. One of the important precautions of semaglutide is that this drug can act on the pancreas. So it can produce some pancreatitis as one of the important side effects. So in those patients with any history of pancreatitis, this drug should be carefully given. And during the treatment, if any symptoms such as severe abdominal pain, nausea and vomiting, unexpected weight loss, all these should be carefully monitored. All these may indicate development of pancreatitis. So in such patients, this semaglutide should be carefully given. Similarly, this drug can increase the risk of diabetic retinopathy. Normally, the excessive glucose levels may result in the diabetic retinopathy. So, in such patients, semaglutide can further increase the risk. Even it is going to reduce the glucose levels. But the risk of diabetic retinopathy is increased by semaglutide. So, in the diabetic patients with already developed diabetic retinopathy, this drug should not be used. Since this drug is going to reduce the glucose levels, it can produce hypoglycemia, so some weakness can be observed in the patients, and this may further increase by other drugs like insulin secretagogues. For instance, sulfonylureas can act on beta cells, and they also increase the secretion of insulin from the beta cells. So this insulin again produces hypoglycemia, so when this semaglutide is combined with insulin secretagogues like sulfonylureas, this combination may produce significant hypoglycemia. Similarly, insulin preparations can also increase the hypoglycemia produced by semaglutide. So when these drugs are combined with this semaglutide, care should be taken to reduce the risk of severe hypoglycemia within the patients. Another important precaution is that this drug can produce some acute kidney failure. So in the patients with any chronic renal failure, this drug should be avoided. And because of this acute kidney failure, semaglutide may produce few of the symptoms such as severe diarrhea, nausea and vomiting, and dehydration. If any of these symptoms are observed during the treatment of semaglutide, then the kidney functionality should be assessed in order to check any development of acute kidney failure. Finally, this drug can produce some hypersensitivity resulting in the angioedema, swelling of lips, tongue, face and neck. It can also produce some anaphylaxis resulting in skin rashes, urticaria. In such conditions, this drug should be avoided. This drug may increase the risk of thyroid C-cell carcinoma. So thyroid cancer may be increased with semaglutide on long-term therapy. It can develop a mass within the neck, resulting in dysphagia, difficulty in swallowing. That's why semaglutide is not indicated as a first-line therapy. Along with other antidiabetic agents, this drug can be given in order to reduce the risk of thyroid cancer. Now let us see the side effects of this drug. Semaglutide mainly produces gastrointestinal side effects resulting in abdominal pain, diarrhea. It can produce some loss of appetite which results in the reduction of body weight. And it can produce some dyspepsia, indigestion, and flatulence can be observed with this semaglutide. How it is given? This drug is available as a tablet which can be used for the management of type 2 diabetes mellitus. But this tablet should be given at least 30 minutes before the first food intake. That's why it can be given in the early morning, and 30 minutes gap should be maintained between the administration of this tablet and any intake of food or even beverages. And this tablet should be taken with plain water. It should not be combined with other liquids, since the food can reduce the absorption of semaglutide. And this drug is given at an initial dose of 3 mg given once daily. After 30 days of the treatment, the dose can be slightly increased to 7 mg, again given as once daily. Based on the efficacy of the treatment, further dose increments can be done. Again, after 30 days, the dose may be increased up to 14 mg given once daily. So the maximum dose is the 14 mg given as a single dose per day in order to control the blood glucose levels. Similarly, it is available as a subcutaneous injection, again indicated for the management of type 2 diabetes mellitus. The initial dose is 0.25 mg subcutaneous injection given once for a week. Again, the dose can be increased after 4 weeks of the treatment. It can be given at a dose of 0.5 mg, which is used as a maintenance dose given for every week in order to control the blood glucose levels. And finally, this drug is also available as subcutaneous injection for the management of obesity. For this purpose, the initial dose is again 0.25 mg given once a week. And the dose can be increased based on the goals of the treatment, but the increment should be done after 4 weeks of the treatment. So the dose can be increased up to 2.4 mg given once a week. So the maintenance dose for the treatment of obesity is 2.4 mg. Based on the goals for control of obesity in the patients. So that's about this drug semaglutide, which is one of the long-acting GLP-1 receptor agonist. This drug is orally available to control the type 2 diabetes mellitus. It is also available as subcutaneous injection. Another formulation is available as a subcutaneous injection for the management of obesity. So this drug can be used for management of both type 2 diabetes mellitus as well as for obesity. Pancreatitis is one of the important side effects that can be observed with this drug. And this drug can also increase the risk of development of thyroid cancer. So that's why this drug is not used as a first-line therapy. It can be combined with other antidiabetic agents to produce better control on blood glucose levels. So that's for all about this drug, semaglutide. That's for today. Hope you have enjoyed this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel, share this video with your friends, post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.